The term porphyry is used in igneous petrology to describe rocks that have distinct crystal sizes caused by different rates of cooling and thus different rates of crystal growth. The large crystals in a porphyry are called phenocrysts and can be any mineral characteristic of an igneous rock, although feldspar crystals are most common. There is no specific delineation as to how big the phenocryst must be compared to the smaller surrounding crystals. It is simply stated that the distinction between the two should be obvious. It can be said that most igneous rocks are porphyritic to some degree. This video starts with one of my favorite porphyries. It is a porphyritic basalt with phenocrysts of plagioclase feldspar. That name in itself should make it one of your favorite igneous rocks as well, but there is more to the rock than just a good geologic name. To start, this rock was found in the Salt River, Maricopa County, Arizona, so its actual provenance is in question, but that does not detract from the geological lessons it provides. This porphyry is an extrusive or volcanic igneous rock as indicated by the very fine-grained charcoal gray ground mass. Ground mass is the geological term used to describe the very fine-grained rock surrounding the larger crystals. There are also many vesicles that are trapped gas bubbles. Both the very fine-grained nature of the ground mass and the presence of vesicles indicates this rock formed from lava at the surface. The crystals in this rock are plagioclase, which is a family name that includes albite at the sodium-rich end and anorthite at the calcium-rich end. This chart shows the individual members of the plagioclase series of minerals and their percentages of sodium and calcium. As you can see, anorthite starts off with nearly all calcium in its crystal structure, and albite is nearly all sodium. This is what happened. While still deep beneath the surface, the magma body that created this rock began to cool. Cooling allowed the crystals of plagioclase to develop. These initial crystals were low in sodium and high in calcium and were thus dark in color. As the amount of calcium in the magma started to diminish, the plagioclase adjusted by substituting sodium for the calcium and thus became lighter in color. The result produced plagioclase crystals that are zoned. They are calcium-rich in the center and sodium-rich on the exterior. This view of the cut and polished section of the rock shows several of these zoned crystals. A closer look shows many 1 or 2 millimeter size white needle-like crystals. These are albite and form much later than the larger crystals. Evidently, as the magma was making its way to the surface, it paused to allow the large crystals to develop, and then it was pushed upwards and cooled a little quicker to allow the multitude of small white crystals to develop. This was a short pause for the magma, as these albite crystals are all small and about the same size. Then the magma erupted as a lava flow. The eruption was probably not as explosive as Mount St. Helens, but more like the eruption associated with the recent activity in Hawaii. This assumption is based on the composition of the rock. It is rich in calcium, iron, magnesium, and low in silica. Low silica content lavas are more prone to flowing rather than being explosive. Once at the surface, the lava froze or crystallized to produce the rock seen here. Then the basalt was subject to the actions of surface processes, weathering and erosion. Water made its way into the rock. That migrating water carried dissolved ions with it. The vesicles were areas that allowed the water to accumulate and allow those ions to precipitate new minerals, as can be seen in this view. But the fun doesn't stop here. There are more porphyries to investigate. This is an example of a porphyritic rhyolite. This one is also from the Salt River bottom in Arizona, so its source is unknown. You can see the obvious abundance of phenocrysts. These are potassium feldspars. As in the previous example of porphyritic basalt, the magma body that created this rhyolite also had a previous slow cooling stage. It was during that time that the feldspar crystals were formed. This is a close-up view of the porphyritic rhyolite. It shows fairly well-formed euhedral crystals of the potassium feldspar, along with a few small grains of quartz and rock fragments rich in olivine. All of these feldspar crystals are phenocrysts, while the rock fragments are xenoliths. Another exceptional example of a porphyry comes from about 10 miles southeast of Bagdad, Arizona. Here the granite porphyry has been lightly weathered. The weathering has allowed the rock to break around the feldspar crystals. In this view, the single crystals of orthoclase can be seen in the freshly broken rock, and a few single crystals can also be seen littering the ground. A closer look at one of the crystals shows a slight separation between the orthoclase crystal and its surrounding, allowing the crystal to be cleanly removed from the rock. Here are a couple of examples of this porphyry. About 3.5 miles northwest of Devil's Tower, Wyoming, are the Missouri Hills. These consist of phonolite, as does Devil's Tower. Here the phenocrysts are feldspars, sanidine, and anorthoclase. Phonolite is an extrusive igneous rock that is generally porphyritic. The ground mass in this example is the olive-green fine-grain filler between the phenocrysts. Andesite is another extrusive igneous rock that is normally porphyritic. It is considered to be intermediate in composition between the felsic, that is silica-rich, rhyolite, and the alkali, that is silica-poor, basalt. This specimen is from North Mountain, Phoenix, Arizona. It has a very fine ground mass with a few phenocrysts of hornblende. In fact, the presence of these small black hornblende phenocrysts is often used in the field to identify the rock as an andesite. So far, the discussion of porphyries included only extrusive or volcanic igneous rocks. These are the ones in which large crystals developed as the magma body was slowly cooling below the surface and then erupted onto or at least very close to the surface. This created a new, much faster cooling environment that allowed the fine-grained ground mass crystals to form. The next couple of porphyries are intrusive or plutonic igneous rocks. This is a porphyritic granite with phenocrysts of potassium feldspar from southern Utah. It has orange phenocrysts of potassium feldspar that are distinctly larger than the surrounding mineral grains. Finally, this is another porphyritic granite with phenocrysts of potassium feldspar. This one is from central Arizona near Cave Creek Falls. Now, just for fun, here are some ultraviolet views of some porphyries.